Hey, boys and girls, Ken Smith, Ken Smith Fishing. So, if you don't know, our house is under complete renovation. We're living in this room, which there's no way I would show you what the rest of this room looks like. You can see boxes of food back there. We have no kitchen, we have no living room, we have no dining room. It's a mess, which is also why we've been back and forth to Rayburn so much. But I wanted to get this video out. This is something different because I want to share something with you that I think is a great opportunity, actually, for our junior anglers, but also for those of us who want to support our junior anglers. So back in October, I literally got out of the blue an email, and I kind of looked at it. I'm like, what's this? And it was a letter from a gentleman with Texas Park and Wildlife, or it was an email, and inside was a letter from the chairman of the Texas Park and Wildlife Committee asking me if I wanted to be a member of the Texas Freshwater Fisheries Advisory Committee, which I didn't even know existed. And I investigated it, I said yes, so we had our first meeting last week in Austin, Texas. Now, this is a group of, I believe there's 24 of us, and it was really interesting to me because there was a catfish guide, there's a gentleman from Tawakoni who's a multi-species guide, there's landowners, there's a couple of fly shop owners, and one of those gentlemen, I did not realize the pollution problems they've been having in Brady Branch, which is a beautiful stretch of river down there where they catch Guadalupe bass, which, by the way, is kind of on my things I've always wanted to do. I think Texas is the only place you can catch a Guadalupe bass. If you've never seen one, I'll try to stick a picture in right there. They're absolutely beautiful. They kind of have the colorings of a smallmouth. They don't get huge, but that little stretch of river is one of the best rivers or one of the prettiest rivers in Texas, and also a great place to catch those fish. And it's been polluted by a couple of the cities down there. And so one of the guys on this committee is very involved in fighting, trying to get those rivers cleaned up. There's just broad, wide walks of life. There's a gentleman that's with the Sabine River Authority that's on the committee. Who else? There's a guy who's in pond management on the committee, which I thought was really interesting. He works with ranchers to help manage ponds. So a lot of really interesting folks with a lot of different outlooks, but all of us interested in sort of the future of our fisheries, the future of our waterways. And it's an offshoot. So if you know anything about Texas Park and Wildlife, it's broken up in divisions. And one of the divisions that, for example, Todd Driscoll works with, two different Todds live very close together, but that we did the interviews with last year with Todd on the tracking studies at Ford. Todd works for the freshwater fisheries part of Texas Park and Wildlife. So it's one of the divisions. There's these committees across most of the divisions, like the Parks Department. They have a committee as well. And our job is to give input, to give feedback to them. One of the things we did at this meeting was they reviewed for us upcoming changes that they're proposing to the legislation for regulation changes and why they do those things. And just a lot of really, really fascinating stuff. So needless to say, it's probably the most engaged I've been in a committee. I mean, I've sat on some boards and some different things for money, but you know, around businesses, but this is the first one that's really kind of hit home in my passion. And I got really, really fired up. I learned a bunch of stuff. I realized it's one of those things where you kind of find out how little you know about something, and it just made me really curious to learn more about it. So our next meeting is going to be at Athens in April, so I'll give y'all a lot more update on that. But two things I wanted to share with you today that I thought, one of them is extremely time sensitive. So the American Fisheries Society is a nonprofit. It was formed in 1870, so it's 152 years old now, I guess, 153 years old. And their stated goal is to advance fisheries science, or the fisheries sciences. And they have something that they do every year called a Hutton sponsor. It's called a Hutton Scholar. This is not just Texas. This is every state across the country. They have the ability to award these in all 50 states, Canada, Mexico, and Puerto Rico. And what it is they are looking for, they say the class of 23 to 25. So 11th graders to graduating seniors who have an interest in working in the field of fishery sciences. And what they do, so you make an application, the deadline for the application is February the 14th. There'll be a link below where you can go investigate this and make an application if you're interested. But it is an 8-week paid summer internship where you would go and work with somebody in fishery sciences. For example, like somebody, I'm not saying Todd's one of them, but like somebody like Todd, somebody who works for Texas Park and Wildlife or another organization that works around fishery science. And I think that's really fascinating. It's a paid internship. I think there'll be, if I remember what they said, and please don't hold me to this, I think there'll be 6 in Texas and maybe more if we help them more. And I'll talk about that in just a second. But it's just something I wanted the guy. I know we've got a ton of young men and women across Texas, high schoolers who are into fishing. If you're interested in, by the way, I never have mentioned this to you guys. When I was a senior in high school, I almost went to University of Arkansas at Monticello because I was interested in being a park ranger. That was something that interested me, and some things changed in my life that caused me not to go that direction. But had this been available when I was a senior in high school, I would have been all over this to go learn about more about fishery sciences. So the application period opened in December. It closes February the 14th. So if you're interested in doing that, again, there'll be a link below where you can go do that. Also, they are interested in finding people who are interested in being mentors. So if any of you guys work out there in areas like this and would be interested in being a mentor, I'll put a link to that as well. And the third link I'll put below is if you're interested in supporting American Fisheries Society, specific to the Hutton Scholar Program, I'll put a giving link down there as well. So I wanted to get that out because, again, we've got, it's the 16th today. You guys will see this the 17th. So there's a little bit less than a month to get on the stick and make application. I think this is a great opportunity, and you can learn more about it at that website. Okay, one other thing that I found really interesting was recently, and I think maybe within the last 3 or 4 weeks, Texas Park and Wildlife has come out with a position paper on hydrilla. Now, from the stuff we did with, I had to do a little stop there for a second. So remember we did a video back, when did we do those videos? With John, who is this was back, I'll put a link below. These were posted, doggone, I can't tell when they were posted. But back, let's say 6 or 8 months ago, with John, who is over the Freshwater Fisheries Invasive Species Division, we talked a lot about aquatic vegetation. And I know one of the feedback I got privately and publicly from a lot of you guys was Texas Park and Wildlife trying to kill all the hydrilla, which I can assure you, having talked to Texas Park and Wildlife, is absolutely not the case. This position paper sets forth their current belief or their current standing on hydrilla. And what I'll tell you is, unless it's absolutely choking a lake out or absolutely choking out the ability to draw water from a lake, you can see in this piece, their biologists all say, and it says right in this paper, we believe aquatic vegetation is good for our fisheries and good for the fish. So I will put a link to that down below as well, because I think that's something a lot of you guys will enjoy reading. And again, I am now on the Freshwater Fisheries Advisory Committee, so I am accepting any feedback you guys have. And I talked about this quite a bit as we went around the room and talked about different things. One of the topics was, what are you guys interested in having future meetings topics? And mine were a couple. Specifically, one of them was hydrilla invasive species, why it's not growing back, how do we fix that? The other one was back to Toledo Bend. There's been such a decline in fishing Toledo Bend. I think there is some belief that it's due to over-harvesting. There's some conversation about why can't Louisiana and Texas agree to a size limit and a number limit. And I don't recall how much we talked about this or you'll recall this or not, but Texoma, Toledo Bend is one of the few lakes in Texas that it's not a 5 fish limit. So we've got a lot of slot lakes, but five fish is not the case at Toledo Bend. It's eight fish, 14-inch minimum limit, and that's because Louisiana does not want to drop. There's still a culture over there. I don't want to make anybody mad, but there is still a culture over there of eating what you catch. And I have no problem with that. I don't have a dog in that fight. I think harvesting fish is fine in a lot of cases. I don't want to go down that rabbit hole. But that was one of the things I want to talk about, was about understanding better whether we can make some kind of a relationship or foster some kind of relationship with Louisiana to get Toledo back to, I mean, it was rated the number one bass lake in the country 2 of 3 years, or maybe 2 years in a row. So just staggering. One other thing I thought was really, really interesting from this meeting, and I had no idea. Two things, actually. Number one, there's still 4 or 5 lakes in Texas that have zero Florida strain largemouth in them. It's all still native largemouth. And I'm trying to get that list, and I'll share it with you, because my belief is, and Albert Collins and the time I spent with Glenn Freeman both also convinced me, that the original Texas strain largemouth was a much more aggressive, voracious feeder than a strict Florida or a Florida hybrid with the Texas largemouth. And the fishing's easier, they're less susceptible to cold fronts, a lot of things. Plus, I just like to go back and experience fishing original Texas largemouth a little bit. So I'm gonna try to get the names of those lakes for any of you who wanna join me in that endeavor. And then secondly, this is the first year ever. If I remember the numbers, and I'm sure I have them, actually I might have it right here. I don't, but I believe if I remember the slide, there were 5.5 million fingerlings stocked in, sorry, I had a camera cut off. There were 5.5 million fingerlings stocked in Texas lakes, besides those 4 or 5 lakes that are just still Texas only genetics. And of those 5.5 million fingerlings that were stocked this year, every single one of them is somewhere in the family tree of a Sherrilone Starwalker, of one of those fish. And I think that's pretty cool. I can't tell you guys how many comments I've gotten on those videos with Todd, or emails that say from guys in, you name the state, Florida, Georgia, Tennessee, why doesn't our fisheries department make the effort to produce giant bass that Texas has? And I don't know, in California, I've got a ton of guys out of California, because it seems in some places in California, they're trying to eradicate bass versus let them grow as big as they could grow out there. So there's so much stuff I found interesting in these meetings. I will continue to share with you guys. If you have things specific that you would like for me to bring up, I'm glad to do that. You guys know how to reach me. KenSmithFishing@outlook.com is way better than a comment. I'm to the point now, I cannot get to all the comments on my videos, but I still answer every single email. And if you've emailed me and I haven't answered you, email me again and hey man, you missed me, because I promise you I try to respond to every single one of them. So later this week, we're gonna do the BFL tournament footage from Rayburn. That footage is dated about 10 days old now. By the time you guys see it, probably 12 days old, but I still wanted to get it up because we had a good time, caught a bunch of fish. But I wanted to get this up specifically for you young folks who are interested in becoming Hutton Scholars. I wanted to give you the opportunity to do that. So thanks for tuning in. Again, as always, thanks for watching. I'm up over 18,000 subscribers. I don't grow my channel as fast as many. I would love to, but so if you guys have a buddy you think might be interested in my channel, I would appreciate it. If you don't subscribe, I'd appreciate it if you'd click that subscribe button and help me grow my subscribership so that I can continue doing more of this fun stuff that I love doing. And I will say to you in closing, I got kind of a little bit choked up down there when I realized that this channel and my fishing had put me in a position to help my boys have better fishing in their future. Landon will be 2 here in a couple months. Hollis will be 4 in the summer. And they already, it's all about daddy's boat, daddy's fishing. Daddy's boat's very fast, by the way. Daddy's boat fast is what I hear a lot. You guys saw, as a matter of fact, I'm gonna stick the clip in here at the end of our little boat ride the other evening, but it really made me feel good. You know, with the spark thing a couple of years ago, I brought 2 Texas fishermen almost $100,000 in prize money and gift certificates and awards and drawings that would not have been in the fishing industry otherwise. And I felt like I was giving back to my fishing community when I did that, and I feel like this gives me another opportunity to do that, and I'm excited about it, and I'm very appreciative of Park and Wildlife putting the confidence in me to let me sit on this committee. So thanks for tuning in, guys. We'll see y'all on Thursday with more fishing, and again next week with some more good stuff. See you soon.